The biorobots. Brave young men who climbed the deadly rooftops of Chernobyl's reactor 4 to clean radioactive rubble. In those early days of 1986, each mission lasted less than a minute. It was just enough time to absorb the maximum permitted dose of radiation, sealing the fates of many. Yet, behind their story lies a detail a few know about. In the same period was created a technology that, if prioritized, could save health and lives of many of those people. This is a story of one more remarkable invention born in Chernobyl in 1986, the Project Blotter. The roofs had to be cleaned to make it safe to build the sarcophagus of reactor 4. A major obstacle was that the rooftops were covered in rolled bitumen. So, when the reactor exploded, hot fragments of the core embedded themselves into the bitumen, fusing with it. We recently translated a detailed report on this written by Yuri Samolenko. You can find it on our Patreon page, and it includes these truly haunting maps. Samolenko explains that attempts to use robots largely failed. Water cannons or hydro monitors did a slightly better job by blasting away the debris, but even they weren't a complete solution. And this brings us to the work of Helen Kozlova. She was a scientist at the Research and Design Institute of Installation Technology, one of the core institutes behind the sarcophagus design. Originally, that was the idea of Samolenko. Simply put, to drop an object coated in adhesive onto the roof, which would attach to radioactive debris, allowing it to be removed in one piece. But it was Helen who, in more than 100 days in the zone, developed this concept into the decontamination method known as blotter. To experiment with this concept, the team built a test plot near the power plant's concrete factories. This simulated rooftop environment allowed them to test and refine methods for dismantling, securing, and decontaminating the plant's actual roofs. And after a few trials, the optimal design emerged. So they used 1 to 10 meters or 3 to 32 foot chain link mesh, typically used for fencing, which was mounted on a frame that could tilt 90 degrees. Each cell of the mesh was manually filled with makeshift cotton brushes. Once the mesh was fully covered, it was removed, rolled up, and wrapped in plastic. On one of narrow edges, a metal rebar pyramid was attached as crane target for removal. This entire assembly was then transported to the power plant site. Meanwhile, chemists at the power plant were preparing a special adhesive called Espaget 309. This was a thick compound based on phenol formaldehyde resin, which hardened upon exposure to air. It was mixed in concrete mixers and then poured into large dipping tanks. The mesh, or blotter, was attached to a crane, and with the help of people soaked well in the adhesive. Then it was carefully loaded onto a truck, which later brought it for reactor 4. Depending on availability, the blotters were lifted to the roof either by a demag crane or by helicopter. Needless to say, precision was critical, as each blotter had to be accurately placed without overlap. After a few hours, the adhesive had set, and the crane removed the blotter along with contaminated bitumen. Removing it was quite challenging, as the crane boom often faced intense strain. Still, this method eliminated the need for people on the roof and significantly reduced contamination levels. And once the area was cleaned, it was sprayed remotely with so-called VL compound that formed a protective dust sealing film. This technology, however, faced several challenges. By 1986, the sarcophagus construction over Unit 4 was underway on a strict timeline. The demag cranes were in constant use, so helicopters often had to place and retrieve the blotters. I guess you can imagine how challenging this was in the most contaminated areas, with the famous VT2 chimney creating an additional obstacle. Nevertheless, the helicopter pilots did their heroic job, and Helen Kozlova recalled. We could decontaminate around 300 square meters of the most contaminated roof, but soon we had to stop, because the helicopters kicked up dust, making problems for the sarcophagus builders. During briefings, management would scold us for not doing enough, claiming our technology was underdeveloped. I wondered and where and when we are supposed to develop it if it was being created right here. But they kept reading us. That's it. We are building platforms and sending up soldiers to clean it by hand. Well, to be fair, in some places there were no real alternatives to sending people into these areas. But there were many others, and only due to the tight schedule and equipment shortages, Heaven's blotters couldn't be deployed to their full potential. Once the sarcophagus was completed, however, the roofs still needed cleaning, and people could now work there for much more than just 1 minute at a time. We already knew how many people had been exposed in 1986, and we fought hard for our method to be used. Once, after yet another pressure on site, "Why are you removing so little?" I broke down. I just sat in the truck and cried. The pressure mainly came from the military, and fortunately the chief engineer of sarcophagus construction, Viktor Ochriminko, stepped in to help. He personally inspected the roofs and pledged his support. So they started using the blotters on the turbine hall roof, where for convenience CCTV cameras were installed. These cameras you can see in this image, taken at the edge of the turbine hall, and you may remember from our past videos how important this device were. In 1986, they used blotters were simply dropped into the destroyed reactor. Later, after the sarcophagus was complete, they were compressed into a crash truck and moved to the Pidlisny repository we told you about last week. With the Demag cranes now more available, placing the blotters became easier. But the issue with the crane boom tension persisted. Heaven's colleagues created a remarkable tool to address it. Basically some sort of sleds with specially designed blades in their runners. Positioned on the roof, they cut through the roofing felt as the crane cables pulled them, easing the tension on the crane's booms. Despite being at the power plant from the very beginning, we couldn't really insist on using our method sooner, though we finally implemented it in 1987. Just think how many people we could actually have spared from radiation exposure. This was just one of many fascinating technologies developed in Chernobyl. We will continue exploring more in our future episodes. And for more in-depth research, rare documents and translated reports, check out our Patreon page. Each of our posts there reveals a new layer of Chernobyl's secrets. The link is in the description below. This episode is a part of a series, so don't forget to check out our other documentaries, because we have many, many interesting things to watch. And see you next time in the next episode of Chernobyl Uncharted.